Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net. It's the Weedsman Podcast Nugget.
Zippity what?
Ready to drop the bass? Let's drop the bass.
Whoop-de-doo. What does it all mean?
All the random stuff that didn't fit in Friday's show you'll find here.
Oh. Okay.
Hey, man. You got a joint?
Got a little bit of refried smell on your boy?
What that mean?
Please, give me
my weed, all right?
Where the hell did the DeLorean come from?
Somebody built a flying DeLorean. That's not really flying, is it?
Can it go 88 miles an
hour? It's hovering above the ground. This is kind of like when somebody, quote-unquote, invented hoverboards. And like, no, we put wheels on this board and we called it a hoverboard. The vehicle isn't, it's not a DeLorean. This is not even a DeLorean. This is made out of styrofoam.
What?
Styrofoam and fiberglass. He made a body of a DeLorean. I thought it looked rather like flimsy. Also having a huge fan cut out in the center of where the engine should be. Actually, wait a minute. The engine's in the back of these, right? That would be the trunk compartment. Not a trunk. What would you call it? A boot? Does a boot have to be in the back?
Boot?
Where's a DeLorean from? Where's a DeLorean made?
I want to say California.
Oh, it's an American car? I thought it was Italian, you know, because DeLorean. The seaworthy craft does have functional gull wing doors. Oh, wow, hey. Rides on top of a conventional hovercraft chassis. With two engines to power, 24-inch fan for lift and 36-inch fan for thrust. Oh, yeah, you need 36 inches for thrust. And unfortunately, it's nowhere near 88 miles an hour. Doesn't look
so. You can't time travel.
Kind of, you know. It looks decent from a distance. Although getting inside this thing is kind of a dream crusher. It looks like the inside of a go kart.
Oh yeah, it looks like the inside of a boat. Not much going on there.
Yeah, it's pretty sparse. I mean, you need like the at least a facsimile. Get a fucking $50 tablet and have it display a facsimile of
the
readout. Yeah, the flux capacitor and the date readouts that are so iconic. Well, hey, you could be a proud owner of this DeLorean. $45,000.
Where can I sign?
Yeah.
Some rich nerd will buy this shit.
And then how quickly is DeLorean going to the DeLorean family going to sue on this?
Yeah, so they stopped using it.
They actually put DeLorean on it.
They got like a DeLorean nameplate from a junkyard.
Yeah, that's. I mean, you're not making a functional vehicle. It's not a prop or memorabilia either. It's just like.
But some nerd will buy this shit. You mean I get $45,000?
I mean, this is a very select person that wants to own this piece too. First of all, you like hovercrafting and do it fairly often, right? How many people do you know, just off the top of your head, that are really into hovercrafting? You know, they come in Monday morning.
I couldn't tell you one.
Really, you don't have these guys like you know talking about the game over the weekend. How is your holiday? Oh, man, I went out onto Lake Michigan, went hovercrafting. Man, you got to get out there with me someday. So, yeah, probably that's like less than 1% of the population maybe right there. Now, you like hovercrafting a lot.
All right, first of all, anyone who likes hovercrafting, they're in the top 1% of the income bracket. So let's clear that up.
I mean, you can probably get down to Florida.
That's a rich guy thing.
Not necessarily. Depends on, it might have something to do with your profession. Then again, maybe you're leasing that hovercraft. Making payments.
Another niche market.
But yes, a minority either way. Now you have to find, out of that group, who's nerd enough to pay $45,000 for a replica.
I mean, Neil deGrasse Tyson.
You think he hovercrafts a lot? He's got a podcast. I never heard of him.
He'd be willing
like,
to learn.
You know, I was out ripping some sweet. Air, some sweet air cushion on the. They must have some sort of lingo that we don't know, right? I mean, every.
It's true. There's this hover lingo
hobby,
nobody knows about.
Every hobby has its own lingo. I don't know. $45,000. I'm wondering who's going to actually buy this shit.
Nerd!
Is the idiom dig yourself out of a hole supposed to be like one of those nonsensical Yogi Berry is Yogi Bear?
No, I can't, it makes sense.
To dig yourself out of a hole? How does it make sense?
Oh, I mean, I guess I can see where you're coming from.
Like, in what situation?
Well, no, but you could be in a hole where everything that you dug out got thrown back on top of you. So now you have to
unless you like had
out.
A path to dig out the other way, like you. Yeah. But that's called digging a tunnel.
It's true.
That's tunneling.
Then maybe you're in a hole where stuff has got thrown on top of you. It's so now you have to dig out.
Still, I would imagine like climbing out of it. You have to like scoop and climb. Like mm-hmm. I doubt I'd try and use a shovel and like I don't even know how that works. Like scoop it behind you.
Scoop it out of the way.
Maybe. Maybe. So it's only really good if you've been buried alive.
Yes.
With the shovel.
Correct.
Oh, my stepbrothers. He thinks he kills them.
I'm alive. Oh, my God. I'm alive. You were dead.
I saw you die.
I was faking. I used ninja focus to slow my heart rate down. What are you doing? Hearing you.
I'm alive. I'm alive.
You're waking the neighbors. Now I'm going to play your drums.
Like right here, he's gonna dig himself out. You see, they're doing a Sherlock Holmes movie together.
What? Yeah, that's coming out soon, isn't it?
I just saw the commercials for that the other day. Pretty geeked about it. Hopefully, they let him improv. I mean, you have to when they do a movie together.
That's funny.
Not really, a script. I mean, it's more of like, here's your premise.
I knew that this was in the works, but sometimes this stuff just kind of goes away, especially when you have a lot of the same type of product being presented. Mm-hmm. Now, not in necessarily comic form, but if you have ever watched any of Robert Downey Jr.'s Sherlock or another famous Marvel superhero, Benedict Cumberbatch,
yes.
Right? Both of those have a healthy amount of humor. They're not humor-based necessarily, but they are. And both Robert Downey Jr. and Benedict Cumberbatch are very humorous. They're very good comedic actors when they need to be. So not only do we have in recent and even still possibly in production, they're working on another Sherlock Holmes film for Robert Downey Jr. and Jude Law. They are possibly doing one more Sherlock Holmes for the BBC. So it's a flooded market, one might say. But if you have the right amount of spin on it.
It's the hot shit for some reason. Everyone wants to do a Sherlock movie right now.
You know, I mean, that's kind of the thing about Marvel. Like when Iron Man came out, it wasn't that nobody was doing superhero movies. There's still plenty of superhero movies on a fairly regular basis. We were getting Spider-Man and X-Men and whatnots. And then that Iron Man was the one that like really struck. Not just with your core nerd audience.
But everybody.
But everybody went to see it. But, you know, I don't know. Both the Sherlock Holmes
didn't they
is
start
very.
Thor before Iron Man?
No. They find the hammer at the end credits scene in Iron Man that leads to the Thor movie.
Ah.
So maybe this is. Maybe this kind of kicks open the door a little bit wider for the genre comedy. Marvel's been leaning that direction with like Ant-Man movies, Guardians of the Galaxy, the new Thor movie.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe this is also saying, hey, it just doesn't have to be like superhero movies can be funny. Like let's take a new look at comedy because comedies have been really drying up lately as far as like getting really good quality hits with everyone. There's funny movies being made, but they're not being like the wild success of like Step Brothers was.
Yeah.
You know, almost cult like fandom of these movies, like Jim Carrey's movies in the 90s and stuff like that. Maybe this is the kick in the pants that comedy needs. It's something that's going to bring good comedies back to the audience with these genre twists on it.
This is now, if anything, comedy, they're putting it into TV, something they can do episodically. Yes.
That's where they're doing better comedy, certainly. And even then, it's like the funnier shows on TV aren't straight comedies. Like, I found Succession to be...
I ended up enjoying that show once we started watching it.
It's really funny, isn't it?
I hope it's coming back.
It has to. And Kieran Culkin's character is like amazingly funny. My favorite, and he tells the cousin "fuck you" after apologizing to him. He's like, chews him out. Says, "I'm sorry, I chewed you out. Fuck you." Like the extra "fuck you" was like, "I can't believe I just apologized to you."
Yeah,
you made me apologize to you with your stupid face. The Good Place is based on, you know, kind of a half-hour sitcom type of framework. You know, you have the same reoccurring characters, and they are basically playing out the same roles, but they keep putting them in these different situations. And it's a really funny show. It's one of the funniest shows on television right now, I believe. But it's also about so much more than just the weird jokes. There's so much philosophy in that show. I mean, one of the main characters is this like philosopher. He's a philosopher, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, he's teaching everyone else.
Season three.
Yeah, they're in the middle of season three now.
I mean, maybe I'll give it another shot because it's written by and it's produced by the same people that did Parks and Rec. Right. And I've seen articles online lately that there's like all these kind of Parks and Rec Easter eggs throughout the show.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, that stuff went right over my head then. It's kind of, there's a lot that reminds me of The Simpsons.
Mm-hmm.
Not in a direct way, but in the way that, like, Simpsons realized that they could take this genre and they could do anything they want with it. We're animating this. We don't have it barely even constricts our budget to, we can do whatever we want. We can send these characters into space.
Yeah.
You know, and now with just a little help of like some relatively affordable special effects that you could do on television now, and not anything mind blowing, but it doesn't matter. It serves its purpose. It doesn't break you from a scene or anything like that. It's acceptable. And you can do these crazy situations and be unbound and then have these zany kind of like Simpsons and 30 Rock and the jokes per minute type of style. And you feel like all the writers are really clicking together.
I can't watch 30 Rock anymore. Take it off Netflix.
It's not just jokes. It's jokes that are funny because of whose mouth they're coming out of, right? Yeah. They are the perfect jokes for those characters. That's something that, you know, made shows like 30 Rock and Simpsons funny. You know, is it funny to just have anyone say, "Of course I'm going to be wearing a tuxedo after 6 p.m. What am I, a farmer?"
Yeah.
Some random dude saying that, you're like, I guess that guy's like old-fashioned or something.
Mm-hmm.
But when Jack says it, like, it's so funny because you're like, of course that's him. This makes sense with his character. He would be that guy.
Welcome to the Simpson residence, or Casa de Simpson, as I call it.
Yeah, what did you want to see me about, Simpson? This better be important.
It is.
One of the all-time best one-episode characters to ever hit The Simpsons.
Family. This is my wife, Marge.
Hello.
And our beautiful baby, my daughter, Lisa, IQ 156.
Hi.
See? And my son, Bart. He owns a factory downtown.
How do you do? Look, Homer, I'm late for my night job at the foundry, so if you don't mind telling me...
Good heavens! This is a palace!
This is also...
How
a perfect example of how
like
well
this,
orchestrated.
Don't ask me how the economy works.
These early Simpsons episodes were.
All
of the jokes planned throughout the episode lead up to this moment.
Wow.
When Bart, my son owns a factory downtown.
President Gerald Ford, and this is when I was.
And plus, this is like.
Oh, and here's
all referencing actual episodes. Like, this is all groundwork that was laid out.
Sure. You've never been? Would you like to see my Grammy Award?
It's the play on.
I
yes,
wouldn't.
This character is the one who can never
every
fail.
Day of my life.
Fails up.
What do I have to show for it? This briefcase and this haircut. And what do you have to show for your lifetime
and some
of
the finest acting by
ignorance?
Hank Azaria.
What?
Everything! A dream house, two cars, a beautiful wife, a son who owns a factory, fancy clothes, and
it's like a great character artist. He knows
for
just
dinner.
What things to accent to just
no.
go over the top a little bit to make
what
it work.
What are you saying?
I'm saying you're what's wrong with America, Simpson. You coast through life, you do as little as possible, and you leech off decent, hardworking people like me. If you lived in any other country in the world, you'd have starved to death long ago.
He's got you there, Dad.
You're a fraud. a total fraud. It was nice meeting you.
So another thing that really helped The Simpsons catch on was the return of the idea of cartoon having an original soundtrack.
Yeah.
Like, sure, like, you know, old cartoons used to ape a lot of music, too. You know, like, Looney Tunes would do a lot of classical music and stuff like that. But they also had a lot of original music, not just a theme song, but, like,
yeah.
those episodes were scored.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure a lot of the stuff is canned. There's a lot of just, like, hey, we need, a kind of bummer sting here and excitement here.
Doesn't Danny Elfman do the music for The Simpsons?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I don't know how, like, day-to-day involved he is in it anymore, but...
I know,
But you know,
Family Guy is real good at it too with the original soundtrack.
But when they need an original song for that episode, like Who Needs the Quickie Mart, there's a whole orchestra there to make that. That's not canned. That wasn't a computer that did that whole did the music to that. They have that on hand to some degree.
Did you ever own the Simpsons album?
What was the Simpsons album like?
The Simpsons sing the
the album. Yeah, yes. So that was the record. Was it Simpson Sing the Blues? Was it that one with the Bartman on it?
Yes.
I know there's pictures of me as a 12-year-old wearing a Simpsons t-shirt. I think that's about as far as I really went with I mean, I love the Simpsons, but I didn't really buy it. I didn't feel the need to have Simpsons stuff.
Oh, this came out when I was in middle school. So it's definitely...
Oh, yeah. It's my prerogative.
Yeah, I know, right?
Do
what well, the, 1990.
Yeah. Swing it.
Trying to figure out Reed who produced this. I know DJ Jazzy Jeff didn't produce this one. He produced another one.
Oh, did he?
He produced this one.
What is this called? Deep, Deep Trouble?
Yes.
Is this just going to be like...
Bart talked about how he got in trouble.
Oh, there's going to be an original rap on here?
Oh, yeah. Don't ask me why I remember DJ Jazz Jeff produced this. I just remember.
And then, what's her name? Nancy Cartwright had to, go into the studio and rap.
I know, right?
I want to see footage of that. It'd probably break my brain. It's like when you see NPR hosts in real life. No! Or anyone who does a podcast, really. If anyone saw a picture of us, it'd be like,
"Oh,
that's not the weeds, man."
Get to the hook. Tell us it's a '90s song.
Not bad flow. I think Nancy is better than most top 40 rap artists right now.
Or they could have went to DJ Jazzy Jeff. You got to make a beat. No. Some white people
could
rap over. Sound good.
Yeah, well, it certainly went easy on them. We'll work our way up to jumping over our own leg.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? Hold the foot?
Yes. I tried to kill myself.
I tried doing that shit and nearly killed myself. lucky I still have both my patella. Is that what they're called? Your kneecaps?
Something like that. It's not a medical podcast.
If you like this show, please tell a friend. Please follow us on Twitter and like and share us on Facebook by searching for Christopher Media. You can subscribe to all ChristopherMedia.net shows for free on ChristopherMedia.net. Please make sure to rate and comment on all your favorite Christopher Media shows. Thank you in advance for supporting Christopher Media by clicking on the PayPal button and by clicking through to all the sponsors who support ChristopherMedia.net. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net, and thank you for listening. Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.